Well, this makes it easy for me. Our scripture reading this morning is James 4, 13 through 15. And while those of you that are looking it up, I just want to say thanks to the grandparents, the great-grandparents, and the parents of the children of the church, because that's one of the sights that I love to see every Sunday morning when the children get up to go to children's church and the enthusiasm that they show. The enthusiasm to go downstairs to learn about God, to learn about Jesus, and to read the scripture just makes me feel warm and fuzzy all over. So again, the scripture reading is James 4, 13 through 15, and I will be reading out of the New American Standard Version. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city and spend a year there and engage in business and make a profit. Yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. You are just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and also this or that.
In case you don't know who that is, that's Travis. Now you know who it is. Yesterday we had some volunteers, some young people, and I'm not going to mention names because I'll leave somebody out. And then we had the Morrisseys here working in the yard. So I appreciate all the volunteers and who are here working and cleaning up the building. Thank you, thank you, thank you. What is your life? What is your life? That's a good question, isn't it? The Bible describes it in the New International Version with four letters. Your life is a mist. In the text that Travis read in the NIV, it says, what is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. His translation said vapor. Vapor works. Your life is a mist. And you know, I don't think that God intends for us to be scared by that. It's not to be intimidating. It's to be liberating. If I realize that's what my life is just a vapor, and then it vanishes away, I think the Bible is trying to say, seize it. Grab it. Make the most of it, because it doesn't last. It doesn't last. It doesn't last very long at all. The Bible says in Hebrews 9, just as people are destined to die once, and after that to face judgment. And I'm looking at a bunch of people who are destined to die once. Right? All of you. You are a vapor. A mist. A man who understood that very well was Moses. And if you have your Bibles, you want to look at the verses in your own Bible, turn to Psalm 90. Psalm 90. It was written by Moses. You know, when we think Psalms, we think David, all right? Well, this text was written by Moses. And it was a song. And think about Moses' life. Interesting character. His goal was to get 2 or 3 million Israelites to the Promised Land. That was his goal. That was his purpose, was to be used by God to deliver the people, a large number of them, 2 or 3 million some think, to the Promised Land. And so, you know the story. that God, through plagues, opened up Pharaoh's heart. He let the people go. And now they're heading towards the promised land. And the Bible says in the book of Numbers that they get right up to the edge of it for God to disqualify them. And it was because of their lack of faith, their lack of seizing the moment and serving God, that God says, you're not allowed to enter. You know the story, right? And you know what happened next? God gave Moses a job assignment. And basically for 40 years, he told Moses, I want you guys now to walk around in circles. And for 40 years, they walked around in circles. You think about futility? That Moses is leading this large number of people, and you know what Moses keeps on going to, probably on a weekly basis? Funerals. And for 40 years, he wanders around in circles, and just circles and circles. And he's just going to one funeral after another funeral after another funeral. And he wrote a song about it. We know it as Psalm chapter 90. And this is what he says in Psalm 90 verse 1. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. That's kind of cool. He's saying, in spite of all of this, God, you've been in our midst. You've been a part of our life. Then he says, before the mountains were born, and you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You see what he's doing? He's been going to funeral after funeral after funeral for 40 years. But then he looks at God and he says, man, you don't have a birth date and you don't have an ending date. He's comparing God to people. And he says, I've been going to funerals. I think some think Psalm 90 was written towards the end of Moses' life, as he's been watching all of this stuff and he's all this futility, all this funerals that he's been going through, and he's struggling with it. But then he looks up and he says, God, you're different. We're finite, but you're infinite. And he's focusing on the eternality of God versus comparing that to all these funerals that he's been going to. Verse 3, you turn people back to, the NIV says, dust. Saying, return to dust, you mortals. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, and like a watch in the night. That's kind of cool, isn't it? From God's perspective, I mean, he's everlasting. He calls himself the I Am. I have always been, will be, and I always will be, forever. I am. So 1,000 years to God is nothing. But what are we? We're dust. We're just dust. Vapor. Mist. Verse 5. You sweep people away like the sleep of death. They are like new grass. There's another metaphor. Of the morning. In the morning it springs up new, but by evening it is dry and withered. So he's using these metaphors. All of these metaphors are brief, aren't they? Mist, dust, grass, right? I heard about a girl, I heard about this, about that word dust, that we come from dust, we go to dust. And she was playing in her room one day, and she looked underneath her bed, and there was some dirt. And she says, Mama, Mama, there's someone under my bed. I don't know if they're coming or they're going. All right? You and I are dust. You know, and God says in verse 3, you just return to it. You just return back to the dirt. And so he's comparing us with God, and God is eternal. We're finite. And all these metaphors that you find in Scripture, we're dust, we're grass, we're vapor, we're a shadow, we're a breath, we are a mist. All talk about the brevity of life. Look what he does in verse 10. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. Yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. You know when this was written? Jesus lived 2,000 years ago. The book of Psalms was written hundreds of years before that. You understand that? You're looking at a document that was probably 2,500 years old, at least. The book of Psalms was 500 years before Jesus was born. And what does it say about our longevity? Maybe 70 or 80. You know, we think about all of our modern advances, medicine and so forth. We still haven't fixed this. David said back in the book of Psalms that if you're really, really strong and lucky, you might make it 70 or 80. Evelyn's really got this broken. Evelyn's 96? 97. My mom will be 90 next Saturday. There's some that are strong birds, you know, or maybe they're just stubborn. But most people, you know what the average life expectancy is in the state of Connecticut? The average for this state, and you know we're in the top three? 80.1. All right? The average life expectancy in one of the more affluent states in the United States is 80.1. Minnesota is number two. Hawaii is number one. You know why. All right, come on. It's pretty, right? I'm going to stay around just to see the beauty, right? Minnesota, it's so cold it kills germs. I figured, you know, that's why they're number two. 80.1. And that's across the different races, you know, that you know a difference with the if you're Asian or if you're African American, if you're white, there's different things. But in the state of Connecticut, the average age is 80.1. I want you to do something. Turn to the person next to you and say, "You don't have long to live." Do it right now. For some of you who are under the age of 30, you don't feel that. You probably don't feel that. You probably don't get it. I can think whenever I was even in my late 20s feeling like I've got so much energy. You know? I've done a lot of funerals. I've done a funeral for a 12-year-old. All right. I've done a funeral for a 25-year-old. The 12-year-old, that was tough. It was a little girl. All right. I can remember leaving the cemetery, and I was one of the last to leave. And she was in middle school, and two or three of her classmates were over her grave hugging one another. Ooh, that was a tough one. All right. To see 12-year-old girls who had lost a friend. It doesn't matter if you're a newborn or if you're 90. You are a mist, the Bible teaches. You are a vapor, dust, grass, a shadow, phantom. It's brief. All of it is about the brevity of things. And this text says, "For we quickly pass and we fly away." You know, I'm at a point in my life that if I sleep wrong, I hurt. I know some of you who are my peers, and I see you kind of walking around, and I can ask you, "What's wrong?" And you know what you'll say? "I probably slept wrong." At my age, sleeping can be dangerous, right? That you can hurt just by the way you slept. That's sad, isn't it? I heard about a guy who, he got a call from his medical doctor, and he had just gone in for an exam, and he says, "Man, I got some bad news. And I got some really worse news. The bad news is that you're going to die in 48 hours. And the guy said, "Well, what's worse than that?" He says, "I forgot to call you yesterday." Yeah. You know, so. Moses says, "Teach us to number our days." Notice he doesn't say years. He tells everyone in this room, you need to count your days. Help us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. I like that. He's saying, this thing of being a vapor and being dust and being a phantom and being grass, it's not to intimidate us, it's to give us wisdom. That we need to wake up. Moses' heart is heavy. He's going to all these funerals. He's losing all of his friends. And God has punished them. And Moses says, we need wisdom about this. We need wisdom about that dash between our birth and our death. That little bit of time that you and I can control. We need wisdom. Now, even if you have wisdom, it's not going to protect you from being wounded. But it can keep you from living a wasted life. I like the New Living Translation. Teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom. I don't play chess, but I understand the principle behind the chess. That you got to think about every move. How many of you play chess? Okay, two of you. All right. That when you play chess, you think about the end, don't you? That every move has importance because it impacts the next move and the next move. And you win by thinking through all of that. I wonder if we need to do that about death, right? That every step we take, that we need to realize just how short it is. And so a man by the name of Bob Russell said, Christians don't have a death wish, but we do have a death strategy. I like that. You and I need to have a death strategy. That I'm a vapor here. My life, I need to make it sure every move counts. And so Psalm 39 says, show me, Lord, my life's end, and number my days. Again, days, not years. Let me know how fleeting my life is. You have made many days a mere handbreadth. Handbreadth, that's kind of odd. Handbreadth. Mine, I measured it, about 4 inches. Okay? That my hand is a handbreadth. And our life is a handbreadth. Again, it's a metaphor, right? It's a figure of speech. You're a vapor. You're dust. You're a phantom. He says your life is just a handbreadth. Everyone is but a breath, even those who seem secure. Surely everyone goes around like a mere phantom. In vain, they rush about heaping up wealth without knowing whose it will finally be. So you and I, Americans, we love possessions. We like to build barns, right? Remember the barn guy last week? And so we think life is about building barns. And he says, what about wealth? He says, you rush about trying to acquire it, and you don't know who's going to end up with it. Because when you leave this world, you got to leave it all here. You're going to leave it all. So don't focus on that because it's so vain. It's empty. It will not give you what you really need because you're dirt. You're grass. You're vapor. You're a mist. So here's a priority. You need to realize that every day is a gift to receive. Every day is a gift. I don't like to waste money. It's so hard to get it. I don't like to see other people waste money. You guys have heard about these people who won the lottery. And then after they've won millions, just a few years later, they file for bankruptcy. Doesn't that tick you off? You know? That people have amassed all of this and then they waste it? I heard about athletes getting $50 million to play professional sports. And then after they get out of playing professional sports, some of them have been arrested for selling drugs because they need money. And I think, what a waste. You know what's worse than that? Somebody who wastes their life. That's worse. I've got two adult children. And you know, one thing I think about more and more, I wish they could understand how short it is. You parents understand, right? That how short life is. And how you got to seize it and grab it. A man by the name of Tozer wrote, time is a resource that is non-refundable and non-transferable. You cannot store it up, slow it down, hold it up, divide it up, or give it up. You can't hoard it up or save it for a rainy day. When it's lost, it's unrecoverable. When you kill time, remember there is no resurrection. You can't save it. You have to use it. Some of you who are my age will remember Jim Croce. He wrote a little song back in the 80s, and he says, "If I could save time in a bottle, the first thing I'd like to do is save every day till eternity passes away just to spend them with you." Some of you know his story, don't you? 30 days after he wrote this song, he died in a plane crash. 30 years old. The irony, isn't it? If I could put time in a bottle, this is what I would do. The point is, you can't. You can't put time in a bottle. It quickly passes away. And so you lose it. So only thing that we got to grasp this fact. Every day counts. Paul will say in Ephesians, So then, that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. This idea of circumspectly means to make the most of it. That you got to make the most of your time. Here's another principle. God's favorite day is today. Today is God's favorite day. There's a Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. How many of you know the song? Some of you? Sing it with me. This is the day, this is the day which the Lord has made, which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day which the Lord has made. That'll help you remember it, won't it? It's a song. And some put the tune to these words several years ago. And it's a good way to remember it, that this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Today is a gift to you. And it's God's favorite day. It's also a good time to repent. In the book of Hebrews chapter 3, it says, "Today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as when they provoked me." He says that three times in the book of Hebrews. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. And it's very easy for us to forget about our life being vapor. And our hearts can become hardened and calloused. And we not act upon what God tells us to do. And we're warned in Scripture that today is the day to keep your heart open. Don't be callous. Don't be resenting what's going on here. But let God work and shape you. Today is the day to obey God. Today is the day to get saved. Why? Because you are a vapor. You don't know what tomorrow will bring. So don't harden your heart. Barbara Taylor tells a story of a professor that was asked to speak at a military base. And there was a soldier that was there to pick him up and get him back to the base. And so he met the professor, and they're walking to baggage claim. The soldier's name was Ralph. True story. And as they're looking at the signs, Ralph understood that the professor saw the signs, baggage claim. And so he's walking along. All of a sudden, Ralph leaves the professor, and the professor's looking around like, "Where's Ralph?" And he notices that there was a woman, an old woman, that her luggage fell open, and there was clothes all over the place, and Ralph stopped to help the woman pick up her clothes. They walk a little bit further in the airport. Ralph's gone again. And the professor turns over, and he sees Ralph helping kids get up on Santa's lap. Walks a little bit further, and Ralph's gone again. And he found a couple that were lost in the airport, and he was giving them directions on where to go in the airport. After a while, the professor looked at Ralph, and he says, "Where did you learn to do that?" And he says, "My career as a soldier was before this was that I went through and cleared fields for mines. That was my job. He says, I had some of my own friends blow up, and I watched them die. And he says, you never knew when you picked up your foot or put it down if you would ever take another step. And I learned to get the most out of every moment between the steps. I like that, right? In between the steps. Until we take our last, what should we be doing? That's the point of Psalm 90. That we need to number our days. You know how many days, hours we have in a week? All of us, 168. 168 hours a week. Most of us spend 56 hours sleeping. Some spend 24 hours eating and personal hygiene. About 50 of those hours are spent working and traveling to work. Of course, that's an average for everybody. That means every day you and I have about 5 hours of discretionary time. 35 hours a week. What are you doing with it? What are you doing with those 5 hours that could be considered discretionary time? It's actually a lot of time when you use it well, right? The University of Michigan did a study of 1,500 households, and they said that working mothers who work full-time spend about 11 minutes a day on weekdays with their children and 30 minutes a day on weekends because they have more time. So a working mom out of 1,500 households, done a study of University of Michigan, a working mom spends about 11 minutes a day with her kids. Dads spend about 8 minutes a day and about 14 minutes on the weekend. If that's anywhere close, that's scary, isn't it? That is scary. What do you do with those 5 hours? There's a lot you can do. You may be saying, look, I don't have time. It's say if you guys are sitting here and you're not having a good marriage. And you say, we just don't have the time to work on it. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. If you put it as a priority, you can do something to make your marriage stronger. You may say, well, I want to read my Bible. I just don't have the time. Yes, you do. You do have the time. You've got to manage it, but you do have the time. There's a lot of things that you could say, well, someday. You know, some of you, your favorite day is someday. You know? Someday, I'll get around to it. All right? You may not. So in between the steps, I think you need to number your days. And make them count. In Psalm 90, verse 14, it says, satisfy us each morning with your unfailing love, so we may sing for joy to the end of our lives. Focus not on this stuff that you've got to give away to somebody else. Focus on the eternal God. You want to know how to manage your wife? You know how to get wisdom? Seek the one who created time. The one who's eternal, the one that doesn't have a beginning or an end and created all this stuff, he is the one that can give you wisdom. It's also a great day to accept Jesus if you haven't. In Acts chapter 2, it says, with many other words, he warned them and pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and 3,000 were added to their number that day. That day. If you've not been baptized into Christ, man, your life's a mist. You're a vapor. You're dirt. And you're going to go back to dirt. You don't know when. You can't control when that's going to happen, can you? You can't control it. So why take a chance? Why risk that? Today may be the day for you. So if you haven't obeyed the gospel, you have a chance today to confess Jesus as Lord and Savior, repent of your sins, be baptized into Christ. We can do that today. If there's something you need to pray about, well, we can do that today as well. Let's stand and sing.